Our Anchor Presbyterian Church. I'm Pastor Jesse, and a welcome to you all if you're watching online. My apologies because you're watching from our wonderful media specialist's phone on Facebook Live. If you can remember times at home during the last year plus when your technology has not cooperated with you, that is what we are experiencing this morning at COA. So we're doing the best that we can going back to the early days of the pandemic with Facebook Live on the phone. So hopefully you can still hear us and see what's going on here. And this is motivation if you're local to come back and be with us in person. Right? Right, everybody?
Right.
So just to let you all know, we are keeping things safe here because we're not wanting to pry into anyone's vaccination status. We are staying masked. We are only singing for the very last song and then going outside to socialize. And so things feel very, very safe here, wouldn't you all say?
Yes.
So we would love for you to come back and be with us. And especially today, because today, as I speak outside those doors, you all probably saw the band setting up their equipment. So for the first time in 16 months, we'll get to hear the band play and sing all together after this service. And it's going to be called COA Unplugged. It's an attempt to bring back some of the folks who haven't been here, especially these families with young children. They can bring picnics and dance and have fun, and it'll be a chance for us all to be together again, and the weather looks great for it. Just one more quick thing, a great big thank you to all of you who have supported VBS this year, whether you came and actually helped with the kids, like Miss Lori every day with games, or whether you came and helped to prep. A lot of people came and helped to prep with decorations, and a lot of you gave food for the volunteers or dinner for the families and things, or gave to the backpack mission. Thank you so much. I don't know if Debbie's watching, but the biggest thank you in the whole world goes to Miss Debbie Barber, our Christian educator. Magnificent program. It just filled my heart each night to be with 8 to 12 families and see all these kids running around learning about how to take care of God's creation. If you haven't had a chance yet, check out the bulletin board that she made because it's got some of the drawings the kids did one night along with lots and lots of pictures showing you all the fun that we had. So, all those announcements in, all of our busy lives together, let's take a breath and join in our opening prayer.
Please recite the following prayer in unison with me. We give you thanks for all the ways that you bless our lives, the beauty and abundance of nature, the love of family and friends, the joy of knowing you and hearing your word. Send your spirit during this time of worship so that we might dream your dreams and see visions of the world as you created it to be. Guide our thoughts and actions. Bring us closer to you so that we might do your will and dwell in your house forever. Amen.
So we're going to do a children's time just in case there are any children out there, but I made today one that might be fun for all of you because we are going to be hearing a scripture about the body of Christ, and I thought, what a fun week to talk about weird, fun facts about the human body. Hmm? Does that sound like fun? And I bet some of you will know these, but let's just see. If you were to measure yourself in the morning and then again at night, when would you be taller, in the morning or at night?
In the morning.
In the morning, that's right, because of how everything pushes down on your bones during the day. Thanks a lot, gravity, right? You'll be a little taller in the morning. What about, fill in the blank here, you can produce enough saliva in a year to fill two, what do you think?
Bathtubs.
Who said bathtubs? Bathtubs. Bingo, Vicky.
I know.
Gross, right? But it's true. Every one of us. One out of 10 of you dream in
color.
No, most of you dream in color, but one out of 10 of you dreams in black and white. More of you dreamed in black and white when there were only black and white TVs. Isn't that funny? Though people have small blood vessels, the network is amazingly long. how long would you say your blood vessels are if they were just laid out end to end? Do you have a guess? How many miles? Let me say that. You guess at home too, kids. 60,000 miles of blood vessels in your body. Woo! Can you believe that? 60,000 miles of little blood vessels. This is an interesting one. Human beings are the only animals with, what do you think? I'm giving you a little hint.
Chins.
Correct. With a little chin muscle and a little chin bone. Yep. And here's another one. One out of every 2,000 babies is born with a... Don't worry, this is church appropriate. With a tooth. With a tooth. Isn't that bizarre? And just one more. One more. I think this is funny. We share 98.4% of our DNA with chimps. I bet you've heard that. But we also share more than 70% of our DNA with... What did you say? Dolphins is a good guess.
Pigs.
Pigs, that's a good guess. Slugs.
Wow.
Slugs. That is funny, isn't he? Really, really funny. We have these unbelievably mysterious and complex human bodies, and we are compared to the body, the physical body of Christ. And you're going to hear that in the scripture today. And one of the things drawn out is that all of those parts are important. One part can't work without the other part. So we need you here, and you here, and you here, and you in order for this all to work properly. We can't all be the same. We can't all be the eye or the head or the brain. We need all the parts. And I want us to kind of show this. I don't know if you'll be able to hear this from home. We can't all be the same. It won't be as cool or as beautiful. For instance, hum this note with me. Mouth closed, just hum. Boring, isn't it? It just sounds like a bee or something like a mosquito that got in the building. But what happens if you musical people, why don't you hum some different notes with me? I heard a nice little harmony in there. Boy, if we had all our choir here, that could be so beautiful, right? If Diana only played one note on the piano, how boring would that be? If you only heard one string of the guitar, how boring would that be? But we need our difference in order to be that body of Christ. So that's my message for you this morning. Let's say a prayer about that as we get into the scripture. God, thank you so very much that you made each one of us to be a part of this thing called Christ's body, this thing called the church. We thank you that every one of us is valuable in this body. We thank you that our difference is valued. We thank you that you have given each of us a part to play, and we pray that we would play it faithfully. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our scripture reading is 1 Corinthians 12, 4 through 13. Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of services, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by the one Spirit. To another, the working of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, the discernment of spirits. To another, various kinds of tongues. To another, the interpretation of tongues. All these are activated by one and the same Spirit, who allots to each one individually just as the Spirit chooses. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. Thanks be to God.
Amen. Thank you, Diana. And thank you, Anna. Anna's like the Holy Spirit up here today, floating around, helping us see things we might not normally see, I think. I've decided to start these sermons the same way every week. I want you all to breathe in slowly and deeply with me, and just take a moment with me to do that. Let's breathe in and out. Remember the Holy Spirit within you this morning, seeking to fill your lungs and fill your life. And now, hopefully with that breath in you, with your minds cleared and your hearts open, I can ask you an honest question. It's no more body trivia, don't worry. In this United States of America, are we a unified people? Are we a unified people? And what about Christians and the church? Is there more unity with Christians or less? I know that my own answers to those questions have grown more and more troubling or discouraging in the last 4 or 5 years, just the last few years. The world today in 2021, it's to the point where it'd be easy for any of us to just stick our head in the sand and conclude that everyone is fighting and angry and that the world is just a big, unfixable mess. But maybe not. We have another message within us. Believers are called to something more than just grim, hopeless resolve at the status quo. Maybe some of you here would not call yourself a believer, but I'm here to tell you that Jesus himself said that faith as small as a mustard seed, so like a modern day poppy seed, faith that small can move mountains. And we've been empowered for greater faith and action than we could ever do alone. Empowered by whom? You know the answer by now, right? It's the series. We're empowered by the Holy Spirit. And so we don't just cross our arms and retreat to our like-minded corners. We're called to be different, and we're equipped to be different. The proof is in that reading you heard Sarah read today. The Apostle Paul was writing to a newly formed church in a major city called Corinth, and this church was having some serious troubles. They had the kind of diversity that churches today would pay for. They had the upper crust of the wealthy, along with the poorest of the poor, with all the wealth gaps and the different lifestyles that go with all those people. They had the ancient equivalent of factory workers, along with people who had tremendous education. They had men and women claiming leadership. They had all kinds of nationalities with very different ideas of how to practice this new faith. So it was wild, unbelievably diverse. And very soon after Paul had helped to found this church, he had to move on. He had to keep founding other churches. And he kept in touch by writing to Corinth. He would check in on them, but he got letters back that had a lot of questions and a lot of conflict. There was a lot of partisanship and competition and distrust. Many people claiming that their gifts and their background made them more qualified to be leaders of the people than others. That other people were false and could not be trusted. Does any of this sound familiar? Right? This new church seemed like it would break apart before it had even really begun. What could Paul say that would bring them together and build up unity among them? Well, one of the things that he does is he devotes 3 chapters of his letter to kind of a peculiar topic, to spiritual gifts. Gifts given by the Holy Spirit to each and every Christian. Paul claims that no matter who we are, no matter what other limitations we might have, that every last one of us has been given a manifestation of the Spirit. She has known us since creation, and now she fills us not only with God's holy breath, but also with particular skills and abilities, different from the person sitting next to you. I can look at any one of you, and I can think right away of gifts that you have. I think of Debbie, our Christian educator, and I don't know anyone who is better at making people feel at ease and welcome. I think of Stacy, our office manager, and I'm continually blessed by her ability to zoom out and see the big picture and ask the good questions, right? I think about John or Bob or Lori and their gift for numbers and finance. Thank God. Many of you have gifts of being tremendously good listeners or confident leaders of a new project or people who can just tell when someone needs a kind, encouraging word. There's so many gifts here. They're very, very different, but one thing we share in common is that we do have them. The purpose of these gifts is twofold. One purpose is to make her, the Holy Spirit, make her invisible presence more visible in the world. We don't choose which gifts we have, and maybe we're even envious of someone else's gifts. We wish we could be good at something where they excel. But the Spirit, she has her own plans, and all of her gifts are valuable and sacred. Not a one is better than any other. Which brings me to the second purpose of these gifts, to build up the community. Not to build up ourselves, just to make us successful or prosperous. They're to build up the community. Do you know, we can actually tell, any one of us churches, we can tell how healthy we are. Not by how much you like my sermons, or how well kept the building is, or even how powerful the worship service is. We can tell how healthy we are based on how many of you are actually using your spiritual gifts. I recently learned that almost 40% of us, when a special occasion comes up and we need to get a present for someone, what we choose to buy is a gift card. Like to Amazon or a restaurant or Target or wherever. We buy a gift card. It's a popular choice for presents. But estimates from the Journal of State Taxation found the typical American home has an average of $300 in unused gift cards just sitting around there somewhere. Does that sound right to you? They often get lost, or you throw them away, or they're only partially redeemed. In a 6-year period, that journal says over $41 billion in gift cards just went unused. Can you imagine that? What a waste! If you have a gift, you should use it, right? You should enjoy it, share it with others, use it for something good, right? But we could say the exact same thing about our spiritual gifts, these gifts given to us. She gave them to us, hoping that we would enjoy them, that we'd share them with others, that we'd get every last cent of value out of them. But we often just leave them in the junk drawer and forget about them, right? Friends, we need your gifts now more than ever. The world needs your gifts and the combined gifts of churches like ours now more than ever. One of the things I think we all do in this divided and scary world is we isolate ourselves for fear of getting hurt or let down or rejected. Maybe we already have been those things. We hide out. We tell ourselves the world does not deserve the best that we've got inside of us. So we'll just keep to our own people. Keep the focus on me and mine. And too bad for everyone else, right? It's easy to fall into that trap. But one of the sources of a new unity can be found in each of us being open to using our gifts and using them in unexpected ways, unexpected places. Paul makes this incredible jump in his talk about the church. He says, we're more than just people coming together for a service and then back out to our real lives. We're connected together by one life, all the time connected by the life of Jesus Christ himself, because we are his body. Paul says that each one of us is like a body part of Jesus Christ himself. How incredible is that image? I love it, and I never stop thinking about that because I can think of almost nothing more complex than the human body. 60 million cells, 36 million heartbeats per year, 300 billion red cells produced every day, 60,000 miles of blood vessels just in a body. It's amazing. We cannot fathom how complicated it is, how each little piece of it works together just to help me stand here, breathing, alive before you in this moment. And Jesus had a body just like mine. Jesus had a heart and a brain, and he also had a bladder and a collarbone and a big toenail and a uvula. All these parts, he had them all. You see what I'm saying here? He had a real live human body. And now that Jesus is no longer here, living out his life in his body, somehow we claim that he's still alive. So how? He's alive through each one of us coming together and working together. And it's now through each one of us that God chooses to be standing here alive, known in the world. Each one of us is part of the picture, making the body of Christ. And before you start wondering who gets to be the brain or joking, well, I'm just the appendix, we cannot take a single part of this body for granted. Every cell is important. Ask anyone who's ever had cancer and had small clusters of cells that mutated and were no longer healthy. It affected their entire body, their entire life. Every cell matters. Paul does not try to tell us we all have to be the brains or the arms or the ears. We each are our own part, but our part needs to work with others and function with others in order to be alive. Think about it also, those of you who have had a joint replacement. That big, important brain of yours could tell your hip or your knee all day. You move forward, you work right, but sometimes they just don't, do they? And the whole body feels the pain. It's all connected. And this makes me remember that one thing every last part of the body has in common is they all need oxygen. Our church confirmation class each year, they're assigned to write personal statements of faith. And I was struck a couple years ago because not just one of them, but multiple ones on their own, they compared the Holy Spirit to that oxygen. She's what we need to survive, right? Right back to week one of this series, right? The Spirit is the breath of God making the rest of the body work. Will you let the Spirit help your gifts to work, to come alive, so you can play your part in this body? I want to read you another chunk of this chapter 12 of 1 Corinthians, but it's from the Message translation, which I love. It makes it so real. It's that Paul says, quote, "I want you to think about how all this makes you more significant, not less. A body isn't just a single part blown up into something huge. It's all the different but similar parts arranged and functioning together. If foot said, 'I'm not elegant, like hand embellished with rings, I guess I don't belong to this body,' would that make it true? If ear said, 'I'm not beautiful, like eye, transparent and expressive, I don't deserve a place on the head,' would you want to remove it? If the body was all eye, how could it hear? All ear, how could it smell? As it is, we see that God has carefully placed each part of the body right where he wanted it. The way God designed our bodies is a model for understanding our lives together as a church. Every part dependent on the other part. If one part hurts, every other part is involved in the hurt and in the healing. You are Christ's body. That's who you are. You must never forget this. Only as you accept your part of that body does your part mean anything. But now I want to lay out a far better way for you." End quote. That's the end of chapter 12. And what comes after this chapter? Only the most famous chapter in the entire Bible. Paul's explanation of love. Love is patient. Love is kind. Right? That beautiful reading that we all know, confined to weddings, is actually all about how we live out life as this body of Christ. The pastors of St. Luke's congregation in San Diego, they said it really well. They said, "It seems easy for us to pray for unity, but scripture and experience tell us we need God's help to seek a unity that is holy and not idolatrous. The unity we desire doesn't erase those on the margins or those who are different, but instead holds every member as essential, like we strive for in the church." So do you really know that not a single one of you is dispensable? Even after this pandemic where people can think no one's missed me, do you know we need you? When you hurt, we all hurt. You are a part of us. Isn't that just the most radical message compared to the messages of the world right now? We need you. We are called to this radically different vision for community. We are called to this kind of unity where, as a gospel song says that I love, I need you, you need me, I love you, I need you to survive. I can't say this enough here and in 2021. This unity, it's not a call for all of us to be the same. It's the opposite. We're told right from the first chapter of the Bible that God's own self contains difference. God said, "Let us make humankind in our image. One God, three persons, distinct and yet somehow connected." So difference is a part of who God is. That means it's okay if it's a part of who we are. It's the only way we work. I think of our former president, George W. Bush, who I didn't care for much when he was our leader, but who I've since come to greatly admire. And he was called upon to speak at the memorial service in Dallas after several police officers were killed by a shooter claiming connection to Black Lives Matter. What a nightmare scenario. Talk about two firmly entrenched and divided sides, each one dealing with life or death fears over someone they love. And Bush, what he said was, to renew our unity, we only need to remember our values. We have never been held together by blood or background. We are bound by the things of the spirit, by shared commitments to common ideals. Our country has never been able to find unity in uniformity. Our greatest strength is precisely the fact that we contain more difference than any other nation in the world, thank God. And what we do with that is up to us. We haven't been doing a terrific job with that difference. We change leaders, we have huge protests and marches, we pass laws, and still, we are here in this mess. So friends, we desperately need the Spirit. She is our source of unity. Amen. Congregation, the stuff that matters the most to them, to you, the things that bring them joy and make them want to say thanks. If any of you have prayers that you want to turn in with the cards or email to us or put in the comments, we love knowing what is going on with each other. We're a stronger body when we do that. So let's take a quiet moment, take another breath of that Spirit, and consider what we want to offer back to God today. Lord God, wonderful Spirit, you know how much every single one of us has felt concern in recent years for the state of our country and our world. How we have seen neighborhoods and families torn apart with division, and we long for unity that only you can provide us. We pray that you would give us the strength to do what is ours to do, to embrace the gifts you have given us and to live those out in the body where you have placed us. And God, we pray for those who are hurting most among us, We pray that you would give each one of us the courage to voice where we need help and support. We pray that you would help us to remember those who might feel the weakest or most vulnerable among us, whether in body, mind, or spirit today. We pray for Helen Kelly's brother, John, who is continuing recovery after a stroke where he lost some of his vision. Give him strength and endurance and encouragement each day. We continue prayers for Rich Kelly undergoing several medical tests and treatments, built into a procedure later in July. Be with him and strengthen him, God. Help him to gain great solace from all the fun and family time he has planned this summer. And God, we remember, as Diane Ray lifted up, that tomorrow is the third anniversary of the Capitol Gazette shooting here in Annapolis. We pray for all of those affected by that shooting, especially the families who lost loved ones. We pray for all of those who were selected for the jury with the trial beginning so soon. We pray for justice to be done, for your peace to be made in our hurting world. And God, we give you all of the concerns on our hearts, great and small, trusting that you care about every one of them, just like you care about each one of us as parts of your body. And we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
This morning we take the opportunity for a special minute for mission. One of the projects that our church mission committee supports is called Hope for All. For 15 years, Hope for All has served Anne Arundel County in tangible and practical ways by providing furniture, housewares, and clothing to those in need. It was founded by a couple working in the field of education and inspired by their faith. It serves hundreds of families every single year. COA will be leading a special supply drive for Hope for All during the month of July, collecting such items as new children's athletic shoes, women's socks, and bed pillows. Please look for more information on our website, Facebook, and email newsletter, Hopes and Notes. Join me in watching the following video to learn more about the inspiring work of this important mission partner.
Hope for All is a Christian nonprofit that helps people that are transitioning out of homelessness or just struggling to meet their basic needs with furniture, housewares, and clothing. We usually work through referrals. We have 26 partners that are government agencies and nonprofit partners within Anne Arundel County, and they refer families to us that are in need that have just transitioned into their home or are living without basic needs.
I'm originally from PG County. I've lived there all my life. A year ago, I decided to take a new journey. I'm a single mother with four kids. I was working at the BWI airport. You know, everything was going great, but then eventually things started to change. My hours that I needed to be at work started to go against the hours that the kids needed to be at school. Then I started to have like clashings with my community rental office, and then eventually it led to an eviction.
Nicole came to us from a referring partner, and she had been homeless and she was in need of our assistance. So we sent a team out there to find out exactly what she needed. We fill out a 7-page intake form and find out everything that will turn her house into a home.
We needed shoes, we needed clothes, we didn't have beds. A lot of what we had to get rid of. So those things were supplied, even down to a Bible. When Hope came in, it was one of the most wonderful things that could have ever happened to me. I've never experienced that before. It was a relief to not sleep on the floor anymore, you know?
382 times last year, we made a difference in someone's life by doing these kind of deliveries in the Houses into Homes program. It's monumental as far as Anne Arundel County, what we're doing here.
They helped me to fulfill my journey. I had my own plan, but God had another plan for me, and He used Hope to fulfill that plan. I had everything that I needed at that point to make it a home.
thank God for the great work of that organization and so many dedicated individuals at places like Hope for All. Thank you to our church member, Dave Williams, for introducing us to that wonderful organization. And now, just a reminder to all of you that right after this service, we will be going outside and enjoying this concert called COA Unplugged, and that you have the chance to sing this final song after the benediction if you would wish to sing. If you're not comfortable staying in the sanctuary for the song, you're welcome to come out into the narthex, and I'll come out there and chat with you before the concert. My benediction with you comes from someone you may remember. He never joined our church, but he was a former Lutheran pastor named John Lynch. And he's down in Florida. He sends his greetings. And he sent me this prayer as a response to our Holy Spirit series. Living God, your Spirit arrives as a morning rain, showing up like a surprise guest. Listening to her voice at my heart's doorway, I discover her name is love. But my friends call me mercy, she adds quickly. She reaches towards me, cupped hands, dripping holy water. I can heal you, she says shyly, looking into my eyes. See, taste this. And I drink from her vessel, O Lady of life and love. Your stream carves into my heart's darkness, and light seeps in. Amen.